In the Garden of Eden tonight.
Oh my God, 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 my favorite person in the world. I cannot believe I'm seeing you right now.
Sure.
How have I never seen you here?
I have to work out once in a while.
I understand what you're saying. But I've literally just been watching a video of your interview, of your recent interview. I'm a fan of your work.
That's so kind of you.
I just can't believe this. I can't believe I'm seeing you right now.
I will assume you voted for me.
Yes, of course.
Oh, thank you.
Obviously, I asked all my friends to vote for you. I told them if you don't vote for him, I swear I'll kill you. As though I didn't even find out, but...
So,
well...
What's your name?
Latavia. Latavia. My name has so many brilliant
nice to
ideas
you,
I'd love to share with you.
Uh-huh.
I'm so excited. Oh. So much. You're like my favorite person in the whole world. I wish all MPs were like you.
Thank you.
I know.
I think that's why you voted for me.
Yeah, there's a lot I want. I've always wanted to meet you in person.
You have my number?
Yeah, I can get it. But can we even take a selfie?
But I'm all sweaty.
My friends wouldn't believe me if I even told them.
You forgive me, I'm a bit sweaty, so.
My friends wouldn't believe this one.
Okay, we'll see.
It's perfect.
So this is what you are up to each and every evening that you come to the gym.
Oh God, I'm just taking a picture with us. Just an honest fan.
A fan.
Okay, she's a voter.
She was a fan. Now she's a voter.
You know what? Just calm down a little bit. You're causing a scene. This is not called for. Okay.
You know, I have seen the pictures. I refuse to believe it. But I have seen it with my own eyes.
You know what?
I think
it's not necessary. I can explain to you. No. Let me do the talking.
Speak to me.
You know what? Let me just do the talking. I will explain to you everything when you get home. You don't have to cause a scene.
You will not explain anything. I have seen all that I need to see.
Okay.
Just a fan of yours.
Do not speak to me. You know what? I will hurt you today. Woman, don't you ever try to do this to me. How do you humiliate me?
Get your place. Put yourself together. Let me see you.
I'm your wife.
No, it's okay, I'll explain to you.
Look at the embarrassment! Are you proud of yourself?
Madam. Ma'am. It's okay. It's fine.
How did I do to deserve this embarrassment?
Sorry. I'm so sorry. It's okay, get up. It's fine. They come. It's okay. So he's a member of parliament. Eh?
Yes.
Sorry. I know. These are some of the challenges that come with the office of marrying somebody that is, of influence, someone popular. These are some of the things, unfortunately, my dear. These are some of the things that women, we go through because of, when you're married to someone that is popular, people see him or her and they cannot control themselves but run to them, eh? So sorry about that. So sorry. So you think he comes here always to meet
He's
up with some girls?
He's never at home. Every evening he started coming to the gym. Every day it was the gym.
Okay.
And I have to stay at home with the children and they're asking me, where is daddy? And I have nothing to tell them. But now he's here frolicking with young women.
I understand. Can I tell you something? You're in luck, eh? you're in luck that I'm actually a counselor.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. I am a counselor and I would want to tell you what just happened here. this incident is more than what just happened here right now, because you're saying you think he's been, you know, doing this overtime. Eh? Maybe for today, you see, I was here when you came in. Eh? For today, he was there, he was working, and this girl just walks in from nowhere. Like, she just walked in, oh my God, Honorable, I can't believe what, you know, young girls and excitement and all that. So, just so you should know, so that you can go back with peace for this, you know, scene that just happened here. She just found him here and, oh my God, can I take a selfie? My friends will not believe it if I tell
them. But they've shown me photographs of him with other young girls.
Okay, supposing somebody like me who was here took a picture of them and sent it to you. They are not here to see what actually happened. I was. Mm-hmm. So if somebody sent you a picture of this girl, the way she was dressed, and they sent it to you, you would think he was actually having an affair with this little girl. But I was here. So maybe, just so, because I'm I am a counselor and I feel for you. So how about I give you a session in my office and we can discuss more on how to, maybe, I don't know, if you don't mind, because I'm working out and I'm on time, I'm about to leave, maybe we can talk of a cup of coffee or something. I give you my card, you come to my office, and we can sit and chat. I am a well-wisher. I'll direct you to my YouTube channel, so you check me out, so you know I am not one of them trying to divert you. Is that okay? Because now I want to finish my workout and go home, but you take heart, eh? Okay. I understand exactly what you feel. I'm personally married to somebody that is really popular, and these things happen. You cannot avoid it. People throwing themselves on a person of influence, politicians, celebrities, and all that. And sometimes we are mistaken.
Yes.
But if I wasn't here, I would have assumed that actually they had something. But I was here when the girl walked in, and totally, she's really a stranger. He didn't know her until the moment you showed up. Okay. So how about we meet for coffee and maybe we can talk some more?
Wow. I would love that.
You'd love that?
Yeah.
All right, my dear.
Okay.
Take care.
Thank you so much.
Go and take care of their kids. And okay. And by the way, when he comes back home, apologize.
Wow.
Try and apologize.
Okay.
Because at least for today, I was the witness. Eh? And maybe once we talk and we share and you offload the burden, who knows what will happen? Eh?
True.
Mm-hmm. All right.
Thank you.
Take care, my dear. Here your glasses. Good. Thank God they didn't break.
Yes.
You should come and we work out sometime.
Wow, I'm more of a swimmer. I'm not a gym person.
Oh, you swim?
Yes.
I also swim. You know, there's a pool here at Pearl of Africa
After
Hotel.
After our cup of coffee, we can come and swim.
Actually, my office is here.
Oh, is it?
Mm-hmm.
Perfect.
Can we go? I give you my number. Let me go get my bag and then I'm able to give you my
pick
business
my
card.
From,
oh, it's
from
still
the
on
floor.
The floor.
Yes.
Okay,
yeah.
Let's go.
Okay.
All right, my dear. You are welcome in the Garden of Eden with your marriage anchor this Sunday evening. How was your day? How are you feeling? Tell me, what is the atmosphere like there where you are, where you're connecting with the marriage anchor from? Okay, tonight in the Garden of Eden, I am extremely excited. I'm on steroids. Eh? Yes, somebody here on my set just gave me a very sweet comment. Eh? You know, these guys here on camera can want to jumpstart me. More like, you know, when a car battery is giving you trouble, eh, and you jumpstart, you bring one that is charged. This guy is very charged. He just got married. Imagine what he just said. Anyway, as Mr. Farmer or Miss Garden, the people that always follow and connect with the marriage anchor, you understand our language. So when I start on a high note, you know we are going to have fun enjoying whatever the Lord has brought tonight in the Garden of Eden. So in this episode, I have brought a lady. She is going to be telling us what has been going through her marriage. Of course, those of you that started with us at the very beginning, you have seen the act that just played before I came on air, the act of an honorable member of parliament that is struggling, balancing the attention that he gets from his audience or fans, or call them voters, people that are excited about him, people that see him and they're like, oh my God, honorable, you look so cute, banange selfie. You watch the act, eh? Guess what? The lady that was the one that I was, you know, giving the pampering, she's here in the garden, and of course we are going to be helping her and guiding her. As I'm also guiding you, I'm using her as a case study. You guys, we be acting, eh? I must stress this because we get people telling us, banange marriage anchor, that person. I have told you, we do a little bit of acts, and I already said you, the act that just played. So if you see a face of somebody that you know, just so you know, we are trying to drive the point home by giving you an act because we want to entertain you a little bit as well as we are teaching you. So tonight we are going to be discussing married to influence. What do you do when you're married to somebody that is a public figure, a person of influence in society? Of course, that office comes with lots of responsibilities. What do you need to do? What is the responsibility? How do you handle this popularity, this fame, a celebrity? I don't know. Am I a celebrity? I don't know. Maybe to some people like you, Mr. Farm and Miss Garden, I may be your celebrity. I've done something worth celebrating. So, Madam Cindy.
Yes,
you are welcome, Mrs.
Thank you
Honorable.
So much.
You're welcome in the Garden of Eden.
Thank you so much, Maja.
So, what brings you tonight in the garden?
Well, first of all, the promise of a beautiful cup of coffee.
It is right there. Please do enjoy it.
I do enjoy.
Okay. I like that you're today smiling. The last time when we met at the gym, you were. Banang, is the knee feeling okay?
The knee is much better now.
Please.
Yes.
So, what is it? Of course, the person that has been following might not know what actually happened or transpired when we last met. So, now that you're here in the garden, tell us, is there any other thing that you'd like me to address right here, right now?
That day that we met, Marriage Anchor, on that day, it had been about a couple of months when I had started hearing rumors about my husband cheating on me. I had been presented with photographs of him with young girls, you know, hanging out in the gym. And it's very strange that in the past 2 months, he picked up a strange interest to go to the gym every evening.
Okay.
Going out, and I said, why is my husband leaving me at home each and every time going to the gym? No one should be that interested in the gym, you know. And over time, his behavior became stranger and stranger. He would not want to take me along to functions that he had been invited to with a plus one, but he would go alone.
Okay.
And to me, you know, over time I started to believe that he did not want his young girls to see me, his wife. He started staying out late and coming back, you know, either late in the night or very early in the morning. That's if he even came home at all, yes. You know, it really took a toll on me. And even after people came with all this evidence with photographs and showing it to me, I chose to give him the benefit of the doubt because I understand the pressure that comes with influence. But you know, something clicked in me and told me, you know what, go and find out the truth for yourself. And that day when you saw me at the gym, it was when I just snapped as soon as I saw him with that young girl.
Okay.
At that moment, I knew that everything that people had been telling me was very true and that, you know, he had betrayed my trust and my confidence, you know. And even now, as much as you comforted me that day, I really still believe that there is more to it.
Okay.
Yes.
All right. So you see, do you have any further evidence apart from a few pictures that have been sent to you by friends? Do you have something tangible that you have to present that is actually cheating or misbehaving in any way?
Well, there is him not wanting to answer phone calls in my presence at home, yes, which I find very strange being his wife. We did make vows to ourselves. There's nothing we should be keeping from each other.
Okay.
And as a woman, that doesn't sit right with me.
Okay.
Yes.
So let me ask you, Madam Cindy, Mrs. Honorable, before your husband stood for this public office, did you sit and talk about this? You and him,
mm-hmm.
Did you discuss, did you give him your consent for him to stand for that public office?
Yes, I did. As a wife, it is my duty to stand by my husband. But I did not know the gravity of his influence and popularity as to how it would grow, as to how it has grown over the last 3 years. Yes.
What is happening right now is not something that you prepared for or you expected would happen. For you, you thought things would remain normal, and he'd remain this ordinary man that has been coming to you,
mm-hmm.
you know, reporting at a time that he's always reported on. That is what you expected.
Yes.
Right now, life is taking a different twist.
Yes.
Okay, so given that I like you,
mm-hmm.
like I promise, I'm going to be very nice and give you some piece of information or advice that I believe will be very educative and very helpful for you and also for the person, the viewer that is watching, so that we will understand. You see, I have this saying that I commonly, I always tell people, that ignorance of purpose makes abuse inevitable. So when you do not fully understand the depth of something that you're undertaking, even if it were like a research or a project or anything, it is always very important that you sit and assert the consequences, yeah? The conditions, how it is going to affect you, what it will take, the price that you will have to pay when you undertake. Because most times we get excited, especially when it comes to, you know, holding a position of influence. Most of us, we get excited, oh my God, you're going to be a member of parliament, you're going to be in the parliament, you know, salary, we look at the cars, the privileges, the status in society, oh, I'm going to be Mrs. Honorable, oh my God, when we go for functions, those things. But we forget that there's always two sides unto life. That you'll get the good, but also you will get the bad. Yes. Not that it is bad, but you know, when you're undertaking a responsibility, somehow it will exert some pressure on you. So because it is something new, it has its, you know, advantages and disadvantages. Mm-hmm. So at this point, I just want to walk you into a few things that I think right now you may want to go back home and consider. Sit and meditate on them. You may say, but marriage, Anka, me, I want solution. I think my husband is cheating. Can we do something? How do I stop him? How do I curtail him? How do I follow? No, no, no. Now, I want to give you the background, the cause of the problem. I, for one, I do not like to just come and treat whatever it is that you have. Let's say like a consequence, or let's say you have a fever or a cold. I don't want to come and give you a cold or fever reliever. I want to find out what caused the fever. Mm. So that if we can avoid the cause of the fever, then you do not have to keep coming for me to treat the fever. So I want to take you back into understanding what the factors that underlying taking on a public office, the responsibilities, what you should talk about, what you should expect, so that when you go back and you reflect, then you're like, okay, so where do I start from before I start following up my husband and, you know, beating every woman that I'll find taking a selfie with him? Because trust me, if you're a member of parliament, a public figure, a celebrity, you're popular, you are a people person. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so let me first walk you through the journey of the preparedness that is required when you are going to marry someone that is of influence, or when suddenly the person that you're married to becomes influential, becomes popular in society. The very first point that I asked is that this is not an office that anybody should just undertake. Mm-hmm. You see, most of us, we make mistakes in the marriage. You wake up, Madam Cindy, and you're like, I want to be a counselor, or I want to be a member of parliament. Mm-hmm. And you have this aspiration, you pursue it, but you do not consult. Or even when your spouse is against it, when they do, even if you consult and they are against it, you're like, this is my long-held ambition, I must go ahead and execute it and actually achieve it. So you go ahead, you pursue it, whatever it takes. People will say, whatever it takes, I want this seat, whatever it takes, I don't care. So you're there saying that you do not care, but you forget that when you get married, you become one. If you think that you're just, it's just me, it's my life, I can do it however I choose, but it's no longer your life, because the two were no longer two, but they became one the day that you made, you know, the commitment to getting married. So it is very important that before you undertake not just a position of influence, any other thing that you're going to do in the confines of marriage, that you will discuss it with your husband or wife. Talk about it. What are you going to talk about? The consequences, how it is going to affect you, and the price that must be paid. And the price really varies. It can be financial, it can be emotional, it can be physical, it can be spiritual. What it will cost for that thing or for that dream to be realized. It is important that you go back with your honorable and you talk about that. Because you see how now, how you're looking, the pressure, you're no longer at peace, they are leaving you. You do not know whether this is something that is expected or whether it is just your husband, you know, being funny. You see that? But when you talk about it, then you assess the consequences that will come with this office that he is now holding. Mm-hmm. Is that very clear?
Yes, it is.
All right. Then the other thing that I would want you to consider is that you need to adjust your psychological posture. See, this is something that you did not do. Mm. That is why you are here, where you are. But in the garden, of course, it is good that you're here, not, you know, in hospital having beaten up somebody, or someone having beaten you and, you know, removed your eye.
Yes.
Yeah, so it is a posture that you must assume. Prepare yourself psychologically. When you prepare yourself psychologically, you are ready to face whatever challenges that comes with this office of your husband being a public figure. So you need to look through it, and then you prepare yourself. You're like, okay. Most people, for example, me, when I was going to get married, I determined and I committed. And I said, Lord, whatever happens, I am not going to quit on this man. I'm going to sit and wait, because once I make this vow, I'm not going to go back. Yeah. So have you ever made a commitment on anything?
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. An example of where you determined and you set your heart. Some people call it setting your heart, but also, which of course your heart commands your mind. You set your mind on something and you're like, whatever happens, I must do this. Yes. I must say. Have you ever made such a commitment?
Yes, I have.
Mm-hmm. An example, case in point?
Well, I did set my mind on becoming one of the leading accountants in the region, East Africa. And I did make it to the Public Accountants Board of East Africa. Yes.
Wow. So were there challenges?
Of course they were. It was a struggle.
So what made you go through?
I think it was just having the mind to remember why I started.
Okay.
Yes.
The mind, the psychological readiness,
yes,
to endure no matter the cost. Mm-hmm. Even when tuition is not forthcoming, I hear, you know, those exams that you sit are very complicated and difficult.
Yes.
But you endure, whether it means a retaking, you retake and redo, mm-hmm, until you pass, because you have determined and your mind is ready.
Yes.
So that is the psychological readiness that I am talking about. Of course, when you're married to someone that is of influence, like now your husband, the Honorable, you need to agree on some ground rules.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. You remember, you sit and you're like, okay, what does your work entail? How is your day like? So that when he is out of his schedule, then you no, but you said, you know, your work from the plenary sessions, you go here, you go there, you do this. When you go to the gym, 2 hours, but now you're coming at 8 a.m. in the morning. You left at 8 a.m., you're coming back home at 8 a.m. That does not fit into your schedule that you told me would be your daily schedule. So what happened?
Yes.
So you agree on some ground rules, especially on how to handle certain things. For example, him being open about whatever he does, wherever he is, mm-hmm, so that you don't have to wonder when people send you pictures of, let's say, because people can do a lot of things to bring confusion in the marriage. But when you know that my husband has gone to this place to attend a conference, and you see him in, you know, in what looks like a conference chair, you know, with pictures with a certain lady, you know, oh, maybe these are the people, because he told me. Yeah. So those are some of the ground rules that you can set so that there's some agreement on what he's going to be doing. If there's an emergency, can he communicate? Can he tell you about it? So that your heart is settled. Eh? Mm. You're not imagining weird things. Eh? All right. The other thing that we can also talk about, which is related to setting some ground rules, is you have to set limits on how to interact with the public or with your fans, or voters in this case for you, mm-hmm, Madam Cindy. I have seen so many people that, for example, I, for one, I entertain a lot of people that I meet off camera, off this set, and they come for counseling. Now imagine if my husband walked in and finds me with somebody's husband, or a nice looking dude, and they are in my office. What would he think, mm-hmm, if he didn't know what I do and how I deal with people? They might find you just holding hands, eh? Mm. Praying, and someone takes a picture. If anybody took a picture and posted it, people would start saying all sorts of things. Yeah, so we have to set ground rules. If you're a person that is going to be meeting so many people in the public, celebrities, you have to know how you handle your fans, mm-hmm, your audience, your voters, so that you're not found in compromising situations in the name of, you see, this one is my fan, like what happened at the gym. Eh?
Absolutely.
This one is a fan, this one is a voter. Oh, these are my people, you see, I have to please them. These are the people that have made me. Mm-hmm. And you know, you do not know how the other person feels. So it is always important that you agree on how you handle your audiences, irrespective of the type of the audience that you have. Coffee is unnecessary. We are having coffee. It's just lunch. board meeting, where in a hotel, which one in a room? Coffee.
Yes.
In a hotel room. You know, those are some of the things that are people that are in positions of influence or celebrities that they should consider, so that for your self-preservation, it is for your own good, by the way, so that even you people, if you do not limit how you access your fans or how you relate with them, they can end up wrecking your own career. People will stage up some funny things and they call you because, oh, my fans, they've invited me, you just go like that. No, it is very important, even for the person, not just for the spouse, but for the individual themselves. Okay, the other thing that we have to consider, or the preparedness that we need when you're going to be married to someone that is influential when you're already there, is that these phone calls mm-hmm. you just mentioned it,
yes,
that when he's picking his phone,
he steps out of the house.
So then you're wondering who has called,
yeah,
that he cannot answer in my presence and say whatever they
after
have
we got say. We made a pact that whoever calls you has called us. So if the phone calls at night, baby, who has called us? But now he just walks out of the room.
You ask him that, baby, who has called us?
Yes, if somebody calls me, he asks, baby, who has called us? Because when that phone rings, it's not calling one person, it's calling two.
It is calling the both of
yes.
you. So if he's not going to answer the yeah. person that has called us or the both yes. of you, then you wonder,
yeah, exactly.
what is he hiding from mm-hmm. me? Because that was the initial agreement.
Yes.
You see, now people need to set ground rules on when to answer the calls, at what time. Have phone numbers that you switch off that are accessible to the public. If it is somebody's personal assistant calling at 8 or 10, you might understand, oh, this is my personal assistant calling. But when you leave your phone, like for example me, there are times when I stop taking calls. If you call me after 6 or 7, I will not take. Until the next day in the morning, I will switch off certain phones and then or put them in absolute silence and then have just one number of emergency. My husband will know that the people that can call at this time are 1, 2, 3, 4 people. And it is always an emergency.
Yeah.
Otherwise, the other phone is tucked away, and then because I mean at that time 8, 9, 10 in the night, what business are you handling? Are you a medical mm-hmm. doctor who works in the emergency department, or you run an ambulance services that you want to go and pick somebody that is about to die?
Yes.
What kind of emergency that would happen at 11 p.m. in the night? You know, unless if you're like now on WhatsApp, watching the Garden of Eden online. That one we agree. You're online, you're on YouTube, and you're watching something, and it is visible. Eh? People
yes.
can see it. Anyway, that was just for me to just promote us. Eh? Okay. The other one that we need to agree on is setting your priorities right. Do you understand that?
Yes.
What does that mean? Or how would you encourage your husband, the Honorable, to set his priorities right?
I mean, as somebody who is married, he also has responsibilities, and he has responsibilities to his constituents, and he has responsibility to his family. So as a wife, I would give him an ultimatum to actually put us, the family, first.
Okay.
Yes, as heavy as the responsibility to the constituents
okay.
is. Yes.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Would he buy into that?
He's very stubborn, so I don't think so. Mm. Yes. He's a man of the people. So.
Okay, if you were the MP, would you buy into prioritizing your husband instead of your voters?
Well, yes, because your family will be with you longer than your position of power.
Please, can you speak to the people that think you're going to be in that office forever? Because
yes.
who knows if he's going to run for the second term
That's
for the
true.
Upcoming elections.
That's very true.
But your wife is here for eternity.
Mm-hmm.
So if you disregard them, who knows how that term that you're in office is going to affect them and affect the rest of your marriage. Because if you do not prioritize your husband or your mm-hmm. wife, you know, rightly, it might wreck them and cause them even quit on you. I've seen lots of public figures whose spouses have walked away just because someone got into a public office and they started feeling themselves
yes.
and misplacing their priorities. They thought it was about the people.
Mm-hmm.
You see, these people will always demand,
yes.
make demands. We want this, Honorable. We voted you. I can imagine.
Even the same ones who praise you are the first ones to crucify you.
Mm-hmm. Do people come to your house and ask for,
no,
for school fees?
Ha.
Pay for.
The one in the village, maybe, but not the one in town.
Okay.
Yes.
So they do they call you as his wife?
It happened once.
Okay.
It happened once, but I blocked the number and I had it switched. I haven't received a phone call ever since.
Okay. Yes, I have heard stories of some of the members of parliament. I remember one time I have an MP who is a friend. Mm. Yeah. So we're talking and I'm like, Honorable, how do you do this? And he told me, Prosy, let me tell you, in my village home, I have people lining up, literally.
Yes.
He has an assistant that runs a constituency office in his constituency. So they always, like an assistant, so they always call him, Honorable, so-and-so has died, come for burial.
Wow.
If he cannot go, he will send Mabugoe condolences. Mm. Honorable, so-and-so's daughter, she was impregnated at 15. They want to operate on her, she's in the hospital. Honorable. He told me that from Saturday to Sunday, when he has gone to the village, people will literally line up.
Yeah.
They will line up, so he becomes like a counselor. So and so's goats were stolen.
So
and so is trying to steal somebody's land. So basically, his life, like he does not have his life.
Yeah.
So, also, as we are talking about setting your priorities right, may I also note that we need to understand who we married. If you're married to somebody that is a public figure, not just a member of parliament, maybe it is somebody who is a CEO. You see, we strive to get at the top in the corporate world. You want to be at the top, corner office, at the top of the building and all that stuff. It comes with its responsibilities. There's a price to pay. If you're the CEO, any emergency that comes, you have to go and answer. Sometimes it will call that you will get out of your bed. You know, you will delay in office, you will travel, maybe stay away for 2 weeks. It is a position, every higher position, the higher you go, the higher the responsibility.
Yes.
Yeah, so, Madam Cindy, I think at this point I would, as far as prioritizing is concerned, I don't know how he's going to be able to handle that, but I would just ask you to calm down a little bit, understand who you married, understand that he has a responsibility and obligation to really attend to those people, because they look up to him. Besides, you know, him hoping that there's going to be a second term or a re-election, he has to make sure if he's really a person that is willing to serve, it's important that you can actually support him and ease on the burden of him meeting those people. You can go on his behalf if you have some time off your work, and you go and service the village people. At the end of the day, you guys are enjoying the salary, isn't it?
Right.
You are enjoying the salary, it is paying tuition and those comfortable cars, expensive cars that you drive and free fuel. Kakati, you come down and enjoy. Come down and enjoy a little bit, okay? Privacy, yeah. I think privacy can pass with setting some ground rules and limits on how you interact with your fans. I think here maybe I'll emphasize, you remember when we were at the gym?
Yes.
He told you, you know what, this is a public place. Do not embarrass me. I would suggest that if any other issue comes up and you are a celebrity, you are a public figure, if you have a problem with your wife, with your husband, do not sort it in public. There are people that will want to use newspapers, they want to use social media, they want to, if it is a church, they want to bring it in a church meeting. No. If you have a misunderstanding, capture your evidence. For example, take your pictures and walk away.
Yes.
Don't cause a scene. Honor and respect each other. Don't tear each other apart in public. Don't abuse. Don't cause scandals and fight everybody. Fans that are thronging your husband or your wife, and you come, this is my wife, get away from here. What? Don't touch her. Those things, don't touch him. And you start fighting everybody, you know, and threatening ladies to stay away from your man, and yet perhaps they were genuinely in just a business meeting or something like that. So it is important that you protect your privacy, the life that you share. Don't bring it into the public. If there's anything, go and sort it at home. By the way, it is for your own good. So I'm happy that you are here. No scandals.
Yes.
No calling journalists and you start shaming him.
None of that.
All right.
Yes.
That's good. Okay. The other that we can do is to maybe this one, I'll just give it to you as an assignment to any other person that is married to the person that is popular or famous or a person of influence, whoever they are, at whatever level, that you will decide on what kind of image that you want to portray. All these are things that you want to consider when you're considering a public office or when you're already there, an influential office. what kind of perception, what kind of image do you want to present to the public, or how do you want to present or package or brand yourself? Mm. How do you want people to perceive you? When they look at you, what do you want them to see? Hmm. Have you done that with your husband?
Not entirely.
Okay. Mm. How do you think you can do that? What kind of image would you want to set for your husband or for your family at that?
Well, a respectable one, first and foremost. One that would reflect something inspiring to, you know, the general unit of the family in society. Yeah, just basically an image that will inspire other people to know that a family can thrive in, you know, godliness and in unity. Mm.
So what kind of image do you want him to put out as a public figure, as an honorable member of parliament?
Well, for him, I mean, he's already doing a good job at it, portraying the figure out there. A responsible person, a person after the interests of the people. Generally a responsible individual.
A responsible individual,
yes.
With integrity.
Exactly.
You don't want him to be caught in between scandals of embezzlement
exactly.
and all that, betrayal,
yes.
and mm-hmm. betraying his people, betraying his government, mm-hmm. or his political party, all
yes.
that.
Mm-hmm.
How do you think you would work, you as his wife? Is there any input you have to put in to make sure that image is actually what is portrayed out there?
Yes. First of all, if he could actually entrust me and let me in to actually give that input, you know. But also I think even with my expertise in, you know, financial management, I do think that I can have a well of input that I can give into, you know, brand management and reputation.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you think you can do that?
Yes.
So can I hold you accountable to that, that I will check on you in a month or two and you have done something about it?
Let's make it 2 months.
We'll make it 2 months?
Yes.
So after 2 months, I should invite you back in the garden and we are like, okay, it's time to give accountability
yes.
for the commitment that you made. All right, I think that is an interesting one. Okay, at this time, we are just going to take a short break and sip on a cup of coffee. We'll be back in just a moment. Don't you go anywhere.
Are you looking for that personalized bridal apparel shopping tailored to your taste? Or do you need to just relax and let the professionals handle your event planning details? Introducing Hems of Gold Bridal Apparel and Event Planning Services. For our unique bridal party, we design an exquisite selection of specially custom-made bridal gowns, changing dresses, maid of honor dresses, bridesmaids and flower girl dresses that reveal the magnificent splendor in you for your special day. Be the daring bride and stand out with our unique custom-made colored gowns. We also sell perfume oils from our Incense Uganda line. With our wide variety of long-lasting designer and niche fragrances, you are only one spray away from having that head-turning signature scent. Visit us today at our bridal shop located at Formatic Mall, Chiwatule Najera Road, shop L205. For details, call us on 0772-954-560 or 0756-954-560. Follow us on all our social media handles, Facebook at Hems of Gold and Instagram at Hems of Gold. Don't just follow the trends, set your own trend with Hems of Gold. Hems of Gold, your splendor reveal.
Be among events and decor. Do you have an event that requires a specialized decor and design? Introducing Be Among Events and Decor, an events and arts enterprise that offers fast-rate events, planning and decoration services. We have a talented and experienced team that offers unrivaled and genius event solutions packaged to meet your specialized needs, no matter the occasion. Whether it's a traditional function, corporate parties, intimate celebrations, TV shows or a wedding, we give you the vision in your perspective. Find us today at Jemba Plaza, room K152A on Luom Street in Kampala. Or call us on 0782-684-258. You can follow us on Instagram and Facebook at Be Among Events and Decor. Be Among Events and Decor. Affordable style, priceless moments.
right, you're welcome back from that short break. We are here in the Garden of Eden, of course, and yes, we are so grateful for Pearl of Africa Hotel Nakasero for hosting the Garden of Eden. We are here enjoying in the night. If you look in the window, the beautiful lights, you know, Kampala at night, you need to come to Pearl of Africa Hotel on top of Nakasero Hill and enjoy the view, the breeze. Oh my God. If you haven't been here, you need to come and check it out. And yes, we are grateful that they've chosen to host the Garden of Eden TV show. Okay, we are still here discussing with Madam Cindy. Madam Cindy, that's what we are saying. Yeah, for those of you who missed the beginning of this episode, you'll have to go back to our YouTube channel at The Marriage Anchor and rewatch from the beginning. There was some act that has given a foundation or a background for this conversation. So if you missed that, you may want to go and start afresh so that you will know where we are coming from before you can understand where we are going. Okay. So Madam Cindy, before we took the break, we were looking at the preparedness that is required when you're going to assume a public office or a position of influence. Mm-hmm. Yes, that kind of preparation, the readiness that you must have, the psychological posture, the physical readiness, even the spiritual readiness, mm-hmm. so that you can assert or understand the consequences of this position that you are holding or that you are aspiring to hold. And of course, when we talk about influence, we are talking about people that are celebrities, public figures, popular, famous. Yeah, so a position of influence. People or individuals that society look up to. Mm-hmm. Yeah, just like her husband, the Honorable Member of Parliament. So at this point, I want us to discuss the challenges that come with being in the public eye.
Right.
I know that here you have an experience.
Yes.
So what are some of those challenges that you think, you know, come with being in the spotlight where people are just looking at you? What are some of those challenges?
Well, first of all, there's the lack of boundaries on other people.
Okay.
You know, being in the public eye, especially when it comes from media, you know, they're constantly probing, you know, having family information out there, especially when it comes to sensitive parts of my family, like my children. You know, it's like a mother hen can get scratched.
In the class, their friends, yeah. know your father is a member of parliament.
Okay. Yeah, these are young children, you know, they are still at that age where they don't comprehend some of the things that are, you know, the dynamics around the family and the kind of people that we have been called to be. And so that is a bit of a challenge. There are questions that your children ask and you feel that you're not ready to answer them. Why is daddy not around for quite some time? Why is dad, does daddy have to do this? You know, they don't comprehend that yet at that point. Yes.
So that is the loss of privacy.
Yes.
You lose your privacy. Basically, the public starts to hold you accountable.
Absolutely.
They want to talk about the kind of hairstyle that you have.
Exactly.
They want to talk about
no
the nails.
Boundaries.
They want to the length of the dress. Why are you
yes.
taking your children in that school?
Mm-hmm.
Are you using our money to feed?
Exactly.
They want to see the car, the house.
The scrutiny is just too much.
It's just too much.
Yes.
Okay, so how have you been able to handle that?
I mean, it's just coming to a point of understanding that it's what it comes with the territory. It comes with the work. Yeah, so it's just coming to a point of resilience and knowing, you know what, it is what it is.
We are in this to, you know, for the long haul, and mm-hmm. we cannot go back.
Yes. There's a very good saying that somebody actually told me once. Those who mind don't matter and those who matter don't mind. It's mind over matter.
Okay. Those yes. who mind don't matter.
Yes, and those who matter don't mind.
Those who matter don't mind.
Yes.
So how do you relate this to your kind of life?
Because when, you know, even the people who have known you for so long, when they hear some things about you in the media, they are so quick to pick them up. And you wonder, surely, have we known each other for a long time? Yes.
You should know better.
Exactly. So this, it really comes to that point where you don't have to be to throw stones at every barking dog. Those who mind really don't matter in your life.
Wow, that's interesting. Thank you for that insight. Eh? Maybe the other thing that I can add on as we are discussing the challenges that comes with holding a public office is that you will stop living for yourself.
Mm-hmm.
Now, this one is something that I think we talked about when we were looking at prioritization. Somehow, you'll find that you, especially if you're somebody that is passionate about serving,
mm-hmm.
I have seen leaders that will go out of their way to take loans, to go and make sure that their voters back in the constituency are happy.
Yes.
people take salary loans. Most MPs, especially here in this nation, I mean, these stories have been in the news. They take loans, first of all, to run their campaigns.
Yes.
And once they go through them, they start now taking loans on their monthly salaries to actually pay back the loans and also meet the promises or fulfill the promises that they, you know, they gave when they were being elected. And their budget is so small that they have to sell their property, sell pieces of land.
Yes.
Wow. So that, those are some of the challenges that comes, of course, not just members of parliament, but look at, for example, celebrities. Mm-hmm. What do you have to say in regard to people who stop living for themselves? If you are a celebrity, if maybe you're not a politician, but okay, just a celebrity.
Mm-hmm. When it comes to living for yourself, that's, you can put that in different contexts. If you stop living for yourself, who do you start living for? There's no point in living for the people if you're not yet submitted to God.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's a very dangerous place to be, because you can't pour into people when you don't have anything sustained in you.
Just let me just take you to, for example, like the celebrities. I'll give you like musicians. Mm-hmm. There are instances where I have heard and seen musicians. I've worked with a few, someone that will come and tell you, Marie Janka, my fans want a new song.
Yes.
So someone, they forfeit the procedure they have to go through to actually get a song that is going to create an impact that is intended, or using their gift to the fullest because the fans are demanding. Mm-hmm. We want a new song. You've been quiet too long. What are you doing?
Yes.
Or they start attacking you on social media. Why are you doing that? Why are you doing this? And then the challenges that come with being in a position of influence is that most of us, we actually forfeit the way we're doing things before we became popular or famous, or before we became celebrities, just because people are demanding.
Mm-hmm.
You know, people said, you know, my voters said this, my audience is saying this. It's like me here, the marriage anchor, when people will say, I had lots of people, by the way, let me just tell you that. We, and lots of you are even watching who are telling me, marriage anchor, 11 p.m. in the night is too late. Mm. Why don't you do it during the day on Sunday?
Right.
People were demanding, they wanted to dictate on when, what time I should do this show. So if you're somebody that is, not that we shouldn't listen to what people are saying, but at the end of the day, what is your pattern? How would you want to run your office? If you are married, how do you want, what are you prioritizing? Are you going to live for the fans, responding or reacting to whatever they say and they demand from you just because they are your fans? Munange, following on Instagram.
You know, especially if it's the people who have made you famous. Mm-hmm. You have, the only way you can sustain that fame is by pleasing them, because your fame stands on their opinions of you. You can never ever satisfy people.
Exactly. And not everybody. You'll have a few people that will agree and then disagree.
Yeah.
While you think you're trying to please some people, someone will come and bash that very thing that someone else is praising.
Yeah.
So that is a challenge that comes with holding a position of influence. And I would encourage you that is watching, if you're this person that is in a position of influence, it is important that you know who sent you.
Mm-hmm.
Do not do things because people are demanding. People will always demand. People will always want you to do things. But how far will you go into pleasing people and forsaking your plan, your footprint, how you're supposed to run your life? At the end of the day, whether you're famous or not, whether they are the fans that voted you and you got an award or whatever they are, or they listen to your music, at the end of the day, you need to remain who you are.
Mm-hmm.
You need to remember who you are and keep that, because people liked you because you had something to give, isn't it?
Yeah.
Or people voted you because there's something that they saw different in you.
Mm-hmm.
So just keep that going. And then even if people are trying to say, now we are bored, we are what? If you keep true to yourself and who you are, people will always come around after some time. So it's very important that you watch out for that challenge and you handle it in the right way. Okay, so how do we, the other challenge that comes with holding a position of influence is the misbehavior by the fans and following.
Mm-hmm.
So how do you handle that if it's just a misbehavior of your fans, not because of you, but these are people trying to bring you down?
Right.
How do you deal with this?
It's really just operating from a point of grace. Yeah.
Okay.
Because, you know, they will always use whatever you do against you. So you should always rise to be the bigger person.
Amen.
Exactly.
I like what you said, that you'd always use what they do.
They will always use what you do against
you. They'll always use what you do against you.
Yeah.
Those are people.
That's true.
There's a saying in my local language, Ntabadia mele tovesiga. That you cannot trust a human being who feeds, in other words, who feeds on food. Like, you cannot trust this person. Today they are with you, tomorrow they are not. Yeah. So if they are misbehaving, let them be. They'll be fine.
Yeah.
They'll always be fine. Always. They'll always come down. Instead of trying to act and you say something and tomorrow they are like, aha,
yeah,
you are the one who said.
Uh-huh.
Or yes. We told you. You see? All right. Okay, the other one. The other challenge that comes is that as we are on this road to being famous and we are enjoying the influence and the popularity and the fame, there will always be people that come close to us pretending to be for us.
Mm.
You must have faced that while you are going through the election period and all that.
Of course.
People that want to, we are for you, honorable, our man. So how do you handle that?
Just to say, even before the election, there are people who were close friends and confidants of our family that are no longer with us or no longer work with us. And you know, time always reveals things, and that's something that you leave in the hands of God, you know. And there's a scripture that says we need to be humble as doves and wise as serpents. I feel like in our world we have too many doves but not enough serpents. We do not walk with wisdom, because wisdom helps you to discern, even by the Spirit, to know what is right and what is not right, you understand? And so, for me, what this has taught me is that the only person, or the what you can only rely on is God.
Okay.
God should be the only person who sustains you. Yeah, whether you're called, because when you're called to walk a path of great responsibility, it's usually a lonely path, and that's something that we are getting to learn each and every day.
You will think there are people who are for you.
Mm.
Songa, they are just pretending. You see the bodies, but their souls and minds are like, they are not with you at all.
Yes.
Until they are revealed, and then you get to know their actions. Mm. Or like you said, time will always tell and reveal people that were actually pretending alongside you. I think this is something that most of you that are in positions of influence, this is something that you face a lot, that we face a lot. Eh?
Mm.
There will be, oh, marriage anchor, we are with you. Oh my God, I have remembered them.
Right.
I have remembered them, and they might be watching.
Mm-hmm.
And people that were like, we are cheering you, oh, my marriage anchor, me, I'm there for you. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 months, you guys, Bambi, if you're watching, this is just an example. This is just an example. But anyway, me, what I believe in is that, Madam Honorable, that there are people that God destines to be with you.
Yes.
And there are people that are not supposed to be with you.
That's true.
But just because they are seeing something good about you, they want to identify with you.
Mm-hmm.
Though they are not happy, though they are not for you.
Yes.
They just want to pretend and be around. We are for you. What? Excited. But initially, they were not supposed to be with you. They were not predestined by God to walk with you. And of course, those ones will always fall off.
Mm-hmm.
And like you said, if you're a person that believes and trusts in God, He has a way of sieving and making
removing those branches that are
the
not,
chaffs.
Yeah.
Pruned and cut off, and then you remain with those that are supposed to be in your life. So watch out for pretenders, watch out for pretenders, watch out for people that want to take advantage of you.
Mm.
Because you are in a position of influence, you have resources, you are a member of parliament, others will pretend to have problems. Just because they want the kamane, they've heard Munange Honorable is sponsoring people.
Mm.
So before you know it, they are also saying, Munange, you see, I'm an orphan, don't you remember me? Or they go and connive with the OCs and whoever, and then they come to you for help or taking advantage of you in any way that they can. Okay. The other one is that the opportunists and the envious ones, of course, those ones, you have categorized them with the pretenders. So we just leave them at that. Okay. So how do you handle the popularity and fame? How would you handle, like right now, how would you advise your husband to handle this sudden popularity as a man, the ego, he's working, suddenly now he wants to go to the gym and work out.
Yeah.
Before he never used to work out. So how should a person that is in a position of influence handle this popularity that comes with the office?
Mm. Just encouraging them to always remember that they are not there in their own strength.
Mm.
That they should always be submitted to the person who has placed them there.
The voters, you say?
Not the voters. You know, leadership comes from God.
Okay.
Yeah, so just being submitted to God and His purpose for you, and remembering that it's temporary. you won't be there forever. You know, yes. Just walking in humility.
At the end of the day, who knows if you'll be re-elected the other...
Exactly.
The next term.
Yes.
Okay. So I think that is important for you to remain humble. Mm-hmm. So that especially before your spouse, like we said, do not be deceived that, oh my God, and you come, you're swelling all over the place at the end of the day. As sure as morning or night and morning comes, the time will come when you're longer in that position of influence, and you come back to your wife, you start humbling yourself. Madam, I am so sorry.
Yes.
Now I'm here. Please be there all the time. Don't say you're waiting for 10 years, 8 years after you've run out of your... You know, your reign in the office, and then you want to remember, but then you have lost time in there, which will not be regained, okay? So how do you handle business? Because most of us, maybe you're just like, when you're, let's say you're a school teacher.
Yes.
And then suddenly, member of parliament. Mm-hmm. So there's this business, there's greater responsibility that comes with the office. How do you handle that kind of business?
Right. My husband and I are both very busy people. With, you know, our different capacities as leaders, you know, and also plus with the children as well. And so we really try to set aside time particularly for family. We are very intentional with that, you know, for my husband, myself and the children. We are very, very intentional with that. But of course, his job is very demanding, very demanding. For me, I mean, even after the COVID-19 pandemic, I can work from home. I can work remotely. But you know, he is a person of the people.
Yeah, so
he has to get in the car
and next
drive.
Time he's going to come back at 8 a.m., you won't be complaining.
Of course I'll complain, but not as much as I was before. Yes.
But now you're getting better because you're in the Garden of Eden, and I can see now. Actually, I'm excited about the things that are coming out of you, because the person that saw you in the other act when you were all broken, right now the true you is coming out, and we can see you actually becoming. I think you should start counseling your people back home in the constituency.
As God leads.
You should help him, because there's a lot of wisdom that is coming out of you. So, yeah, I'm happy that you came to the garden. This coffee is proving to be great. All right. Okay, Madam Cindy, now as we are nearing close to the challenges that comes with the responsibility of being in a position of influence, we want to look at how to handle the attention that we get from the opposite sex, because that is the reason why you came to the garden in the first place.
Yes.
Yeah. How should one respond to this attention, whether you're male or female? Let's just generalize it. Mm-hmm. Now, this is, for example, now me, I'm a lady. Am I in a position of influence? Okay, we say we agreed. I am a lady. Lots of men, position of influence, of course, attraction from the other side. So like now your husband, an honorable member of parliament, let's say a celebrity, musicians, leaders, church leaders, people all over the place. There's always an attraction from the opposite sex if you're in any position of influence. How do we handle that?
Well, for me, it's different for me as a woman. You know, they say in Africa, there's an African proverb that says the sins of a woman are on her forehead.
Okay.
A man can do some things and get away with them. He can get away with them until you have to storm into the gym looking like a mad woman and throw everything.
Okay, you want evidence, you know. Like you have to train
exactly.
him.
Exactly. Just self-control. I can say, just coming to a point where you understand that, you know what, who I am and what I've been called to do and all, like everything that has to do with me reflects on my significant other. If you are a man, know that everything that you do is going to affect your wife. Similarly, even a woman, your actions are going to affect your husband, especially in this world where people talk as if they're being paid.
Okay.
You know, yeah, so it just comes down to understanding and walking in wisdom and just getting to understand that.
Okay, so I'm going to maybe redirect the question by asking, how about if he's a man and there are these women that are trailing him? They are basically throwing, let me just use that, they are throwing themselves at him and he doesn't know what to do. They know this is where he goes for gym. They are in the gym waiting.
Yeah.
Like they even know, this is where he eats his lunch. This is where he's having his meeting. Like they are following him every. What should he do? Some of these people, it's not because we entertain them. They just want to follow you. They just like you, or they like what you do. And if they know that this is where you are, they'll be there and harass you.
Yes.
So how would you handle that?
You can never control how people feel about you. Especially somebody who's in a position of power. So maybe a person of his, you know, caliber, he can hire a security detail.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Bouncers. Eh?
Exactly. Yeah. Security detail.
Marriage anchor is going to get bouncers.
Yeah. Or even, you know, just understanding that you need to just keep those boundaries. You know, if you're going in a place where there's a crowd of people waiting for you, you know, wave at them from inside the car. Yeah. Other than stepping outside and the next thing we are being sent 500 photos on
photos
WhatsApp
of
that
who,
are incriminating.
What? This one is holding
and has critical angles. See, another hand passed where, you know.
And then they are very uncomfortable. I think what you're saying is really right. I know of a man of God. He used to meet people. The things that people of influence go through, my dear.
Yeah.
Let me just tell this story. So this man of God, you know, like our pastors, our leaders, you see church leaders and they are very spiritual. You would think that the opposite sex would want to respect these men. And he's a married man.
Yeah.
So while he was going about his counseling and meeting of people, he told me that a lady, now imagine if this is your husband, your honorable member of parliament, he's in his office, and the lady walks in, because this office is just his room and there were people at the reception. Mm. This is a man of God, but these people, this lady did not fear. She came dressed in these long coats that have buttons and she was buttoned up. Mm. Guess what was inside? Bikini. Wow. Only. So while at the reception, she covered, he told me that she literally removed the coat.
Oh no.
And she told him, what do you see? I am here.
Wow.
You see the things that people of influence go through?
Yeah.
So imagine at that moment, if a wife to this man of God, or let's say you walked in on your husband, and remember this is the person that he has not invited, and this lady now, this is, we need to learn on how to handle the opposite sex. If you need security, like you said, get the bodyguards, make sure that you attend to these people with the door wide open, do something. If you know that you have this harassment from the opposite sex, male or female, find a way of protecting yourself.
Yes.
Because these are the same people who will go, and some of them can be bribed by the other competitor.
That's true.
Of the opposition. And someone will come and strip naked in your office and they start
just
shouting,
to create a scandal.
He has raped me. He wanted to rape me. Before you know it. And then of course, because it's a setup, people are taking pictures and it hits social media.
Yes.
So this man of God told me that after that he determined he was not going to see people anymore. These are some of the challenges, and this is where I would like what I was telling you in the gym when you phoned. This girl literally just walked into your husband. I was like, oh my God, honorable, grabbing, you know, pictures, selfies. You know those, boss, how do they take those selfies of lips like this?
It's not a duck face.
I don't even know. With the lips, posting, I'm here with cheating with honorable, so and so. You see it on Instagram. But literally, it is just a harassment.
Yeah.
So as a person that is married to these people or individuals in these positions of influence, we need to understand that there's a harassment from the opposite sex. Yeah. When you find them in any compromising situation, before you judge them, watch out, ascertain. Like I told you that, you know, you don't have to take everything on face value just because there's pictures. How did those pictures, who is the person that took the pictures? What were they doing there? And all that. And also, some of it, you have to know that it comes with the office of that person. There are some of us, when you get popular, you think you want now to slay the ladies. You want to slay, you want to do what? But also for the male, I would request a little bit of improvement on your wardrobe. You can no longer just go with your pants and ironed and your coats all over the place. Buy honorable some nice suits so that they fit, not oversized.
Right.
Not oversized and all that, so that there's this representation that is a corporate. Or nice or befitting of the office that they are holding. Okay. Beware of false accusations or allegations at any point, not just from the female, you know, people that are trying to follow them around, but anywhere from anybody, betrayals can happen.
That's true.
They can frame your office. We have seen this happen in the corporate circles when people are trying to fight for promotions. In a public office, anything can happen anytime. So when it comes up, beware that there are people who will not be happy that you're in that position, that your husband is a member of parliament. There are people who want him to fail. So you have to, like you said, continuously pray for your husband, and also when it comes, know how to sort it and get to the bottom of it so that then you can be exonerated. Okay. At this point, I want us to look at how to handle public scandals. This is something that, for example, like what we were discussing at the gym, how do you handle public scandals? If a scandal came out and it is true, let's say it is something that's true, and God forbid, and you wake up and you find that Honorable, you know, has a child, and this woman is blackmailing him, this baby mama is blackmailing him, and pictures show up in the newspapers, and you know, pictures are all over the place. How would you handle that? Because I mean, now that's a scandal, it's not something nice.
First and foremost, I would have to ask my husband, ask him whether it is true. Whether it is true or not, the scandal is already out there. There's nothing you can do about it. And, you know, if it happens to be true, we just learn how to talk about it and learn how to deal with it. Yeah.
First of all, we need to understand that when something is already out there in the public, we cannot undo it.
True.
That is the damage that has already been done. I did a little bit of PR, and when we were taught how to handle some of these or how to redeem
crisis
management, one of the things that we were told is that you have to tell the truth.
Yes.
But I disagree. Because there are things that cannot, if you bring out the whole truth, you might even worsen the situation.
Yeah.
So for me, I would look at damage control. For example, you can issue a public statement, but most importantly, emotionally as a spouse, because I'm looking at scandals that affect marriages. You are not single people. That, of course, but you can borrow a leaf from what we are discussing if you're still single. If it is something that has come up and it is affecting your marriage, or it is about your husband or your wife, the very first thing that I would encourage you to do, beside what you just said, is that you need to be firm, you need to stand firm.
Yes.
And own up, especially if it is true. You own up. If it requires an apology, give it. If you think you don't owe the public an explanation, it is maybe your private life. If it is your private life, you may choose to say, no, that's my private life and I don't think I should come to give a statement. You can choose to give a public statement or a press statement. If you think you do not have to, stand by whatever ground that you have chosen, but remain firm in all things. Do not shake. You're not the first person to have a scandal in public. You will not be the last. Some people, when something small happens, oh my God, now my fans, my people, my followers. No, you have to remain confident, remain firm, take your stand, and think about what information that you're going to give out there to do a little bit of damage control.
Yes.
And stick by it. Don't give different reports so the wife comes out and is like, no, he is lying. Mama, let me tell you the truth.
One statement from the entire family. Yes.
So you agree as husband and wife, and then you handle that scandal. Okay, so tonight I'm going to give you my tree of life for you as we come to a close of handling public influence, or the office of public influence, or the popularity, the fame that comes with being in a public office or a position of influence. And my tree of life for you tonight from the Garden of Eden is that when everything is said and done, you need to understand that your wife or your husband is going to remain with you forever and ever. So do not forget the position they hold in your life. This means that, like we were saying, the prioritization must be there. The time that you accord your family must be very special and clarified, so that you know, this is when I get to spend time with my husband, with my wife. Because you may be saying, for me, I'm going to be growing from glory to glory and I'm going to be popular for the rest of my life. It is okay. But at the end of the day, you see those people that are out there praising you, chanting your name. When you go back home, it is you and your wife.
True.
Or it is you and your husband. So it is important that you prioritize them, because the fans can cheer you on, but they cannot meet the needs that your spouse at home will meet. They will never. Yeah, so you have those needs that make your spouse special. So do respect them and know that when you go back home, they'll be there for you, feeding you the way that the public will not feed you. Money cannot feed you what your husband, what your wife can do for you. So please, they are very, very important in your life, okay? The other that I can say is that you should never underestimate the role of your wife or husband towards that office that you're holding. Mm-hmm. Some people will say, for me, my wife is not educated. She's not learned. She has no idea about what I do. She cannot supplement me. She cannot support me. Let her just stay at home, or let my husband just be there. This is me, my career, my music, whatever it is. At the end of the day, if God has given you a suitable helper, He's going to equip them with the skills that you need to be supported, because if they were not a suitable helper, they would not be with you.
That's true.
So at the end of the day, do not underestimate, undervalue any suitable helper, any person that you're married to, because in them, there are things that you need. If only you would appreciate them and give them the position that they deserve in your marriage life. It's a wrap right here in the garden. Thank you, Madam Honorable. How are you feeling right now?
My pleasure. I feel refreshed. Mm-hmm. I feel encouraged. And yeah, definitely won't be going around attacking young girls anymore.
Okay. That's interesting. You can see we have someone that has already been converted. And I hope that you too that has been watching, you have already been converted. Once again, we want to appreciate Pearl of Africa Hotel, Nakasero, for hosting the Garden of Eden TV show, for giving us the beautiful ambience that we are enjoying right here in Kampala. It's a wrap right here in the Garden of Eden. Good night. God bless you.
Thank you for connecting to the Marriage Anchor. For more information, call us on 0702-767-602 or 0782-958-875. Email us at themarriageanchor@gmail.com. Like and follow us on Facebook, The Marriage Anchor. Twitter, Anchor_Marriage. Instagram, Marriage_Anchor. Check our YouTube channel at Marriage Anchor for all our previous episodes. The Garden of Eden, a test of heaven's romance.
Take me to the garden. I can't resist the feeling. Take me to the garden. I want to feel my belonging. Take me to the garden. I am yours.
And you are mine.
My heart.